Hey, so welcome everyone to Multilingualism Makes Better Programmers, a look beyond PHP and JavaScript. My name is Alexander Varwijk. I've been programming for about 15 years now. Last 7 years that's been focused mainly on Drupal. I'm currently a developer for Open Social, that's called Gorilla. And I like to work out, I like beers, and I also like pretty code. I hope you'll see quite a bit of that today. Today, I'm assuming most of you are Drupal developers, which means you work mostly with PHP and a little bit of JavaScript. And I want to take you out of that comfort zone to look at what other languages are doing, what patterns we see there, and how we could use that within our own work. Not everything we see today we will be able to use directly within PHP. It's different languages, different ways of doing things. So it's not all compatible, but I hope at least you can take the way of thinking from those other languages back to your own work. We'll be looking at Ruby, Java, Rust, and Perl, and some JavaScript as well today. I want to start out by defining a little bit what's in a programming language. I think there's two important things. There's the syntax, which is basically the convention of writing everything down. I think it's the least interesting aspect of a language. It's also the part that's the most easy to understand. I think the most difficult part is the logical thinking and trying to figure out how everything comes together. If you know the syntax of one language and you can find your way around there, then picking up a second language shouldn't be too much trouble. So if you've never done that before, then don't be scared and try something else sometime. Another important part of a language is the standard library that comes with it. These are basically the functions that you get for free without having to download anything else from the internet. Something that you see, for example, Node.js, which is JavaScript on the server. Node.js isn't a special form of JavaScript, but a large part of what it is a lot of libraries that it gives you to talk to the machine that you're running on. You'll find also in PHP that the limitations that we run into are not necessarily part of the syntax, the way that we write things down, but they're they're caused by the functions that are put in the standard library and the way that they behave. We'll start out with Ruby. This is a language that I was introduced to a couple of years ago when when with my study association, we wanted to make a new website. And I used to study electrical engineering, so we're all a bunch of nerds. And one of the first things we wanted to do was to agree on coding standards and to make sure that we follow them. And we discovered the Ruby style guide. And this is actually pretty interesting because it's a community-driven effort and it's the de facto standard within the Ruby language, which means that if you adhere to this and you come across a code base by another developer that adheres to this as well, then you should be able to figure out what they've done. And there's quite a few interesting things in here that I want to take you through. The first is keep functions short. Short functions are easier to grasp, so this is actually the definition that's in the style guide, so it's pretty short. If you keep functions short, then you're forced to do only a small amount of work. So this means that your function has a single purpose. It means that you need less cognitive loads to figure out what the entire function does. And as you'll see today, shorter functions are easier to put in presentations than very long functions. Having said that, find the right balance, because if you make too many functions that do only a little thing, then you'll have to dive really deep before you actually figure out what's happening. An example in PHP, this is actually in the current Open Social code base. I'm not going to ask you what it does because it's pretty hard to read. But if I extract some of the logic out and I move it into an external function, then it gets a lot easier to read. And you see that if we have a new entity, we try to load a current user image. And if we have an image for the current user, then we edit in our form output so that we can display it next to a little text entry field, much like you see on the top of your Facebook stream. That's for this first element in the Ruby style guide. Another interesting one is the if as modifier. This is something that we don't have in PHP. an example of how they what they mean with this is that you will have some function that you want to run, but you only do it if some condition is true. So in this case, the if is placed after the function that you run as a modifier. PHP doesn't support it, but they do tell you that you can use an alternative, which is to use the and or operators for Boolean logic. And this is something that we can use in PHP, and it's actually quite interesting because what you see is that it will only evaluate from left to right as long as the condition is true, and it won't call any functions once the conditions are no longer needed. So you see some condition, if that returns false, then do something will not even be executed. And this we can use in both PHP and JavaScript. So in both languages, we have a simple function that outputs something. We have a simple function that returns true and false and prints what it does. And we have a new line. And you can see for each sample, except that there was no output in the bottom right corner, but this is actually one of the slides that does. So this will print true, and because it's true, this will also print true. This will print true, but because it's already done, this will actually not print anything else. So this will only be evaluated if this condition is false. Because this is false, and we're using the AND operator, this will print nothing because it will not be executed. And here you see that it returns false, so we will also try to execute this function. You can use this to shorten this, and you can also use this within if statements, but take care of readability. Ruby also has a special method that's called method missing. You can use this in classes to handle cases when a method is called on a class that does not exist. It's interesting that Ruby says don't use it. There's a couple of reasons. It's mostly clarity, IDE support. And I saw this in Ruby style guide, and I immediately thought of a function that's in Drupal in a lot of places. And this is actually the get function that's for entities. So one of the reasons this is difficult, it's really cool because you can basically define your entities any way you like, and it'll properly get the value from the entity. But there's no easy way of figuring out what properties are available because they're not actually defined on the object. So this is something you see, it can be very powerful, but it can also make your code harder. And if you mistype a property name, then the code will just happily continue, but your site will not do what you want it to do. Above this function in the code base, there's actually a to-do. So if you want to contribute to core, then the first thing you can do is file an issue to actually do this, because most to-dos should be with an issue number. And the next step is to figure out what you need to do and do it. I thought it was funny. JavaScript doesn't actually have something like method missing or the get method that PHP has. It does have proxy objects, where you can actually describe the entire behavior of what to do in certain cases, like missing property names or missing method calls. But then you have to actually create a proxy around the class itself. You could give a talk on its own with what you can do here. So if you think it's interesting in JavaScript, then look it up. Those were some of the highlights that I wanted to show you from the Ruby style guide. There's a lot more interesting things in there, so do check it out. Next thing I want to show you is Java, because something that we may all know now with the introduction of Drupal 8 a few years ago is annotations. But Java is actually where I first ran into it. One of the examples where I learned it was in the creation of a Minecraft mod. Here you see the official definition from Wikipedia, which basically says you write your code, you add some extra details to it, and this modifies the behavior of the code that it's surrounding. Here you can see it in action. You can see there's a class defined, which doesn't do much by itself, but if we add the mod annotation, then it's registered in Minecraft as an extension. And by adding the event handler to the init function, we say this init function is special, and when the module is initialized, please call it. You may have seen this in Drupal as well. We use it for things like field widgets, but we also use it for plugins. We basically use it all over the place. One of the biggest differences between Java annotations and PHP annotations is that the annotations in PHP are not actually part of the language. In order to make this work, we use the doctrine annotations package, and we also use a language feature that's called reflection, which allows us to look at the definition of a class or a function. What you do see here in the doctrine annotation package, if you look at the source, is that if you use some optimizations like the descent optimizer, which removes the comments, then all your annotations suddenly break, so you won't have a functioning site. There is a proposal currently that's, that wants to move annotations into PHP as an actual language feature. So that would mean that you would no longer have to write it as comments, but you would write it in a similar method as Java. JavaScript does not have annotations, but it has something that behaves similarly. These are called decorators. This as well can be an entire talk. They have changed quite a bit in how they are going to function in the last few months because it's currently only a proposal. This means that if you want to use it, you can using preprocessors such as, or a transpiler, sorry, such as Babel. But they're currently figuring out how to re-implement this in Babel because they came up with a way and figured out that that was not the way to go. Short example of how this would look in JavaScript. We have a counter widget, which is a class which implements the HTML element class that is provided by the browser. We use the define element annotation, which registers this in the browser as an actual DOM element, so that you can also write the HTML tag counter widget. Next, we use the tracked annotation on X, which modifies the property so that every time it's modified, it calls the render function. And then you see in the render function that we modify the text content of our element and set it to whatever X is. The set annotation is used on the onClick. This sets the value of onClick and immediately calls it. So this means that if you would render this in the browser, then it would start at 1. Because whenever the element is initialized, the onClick method would be fired as soon as it's assigned. And then we also see the bound annotation. This is one I personally really like. It makes sure that the scope of this is always set to the instance of the class. And I don't know, if you've ever worked with JavaScript, then you may have figured out that you made a function, you've called this, and your function would actually be called on another object, and so you would no longer have access to the properties that you expected because the function is being executed in a different context. And the bound decorator prevents this from happening. So if you look at React code bases that is based on classes, not yet hooks, then this is something you might see used. Moving on to a language I really like. It's relatively young. It's built by Mozilla. It's Rust. One of the reasons they built Rust is to deal with some of the shortcomings from the C and C++ world, which mostly revolves around things like data races and shared access. One of the things Rust has in common with C and C++ is that they're strongly typed. And PHP is actually also becoming more and more strongly typed. And with strongly typed, I mean all the type hints that basically enforce that we're actually dealing with a string and not an integer that was forced this way or the other way around. This is the history of type hints in PHP. So as you can see, we're actually getting closer and closer to being a full, being able to behave like a strongly typed language. And this is an example of all the typings that will be available to you starting in PHP 7.4. So the newest is the string type for class properties, and the string type for the parameters is already available, as well as the Boolean return type that you see for the isAwesome class. Let's see, if we were to run this, then you would actually see here that we can still set the chance to a number. And this is actually slightly confusing, because this is not what we want. We only want a string. But PHP is saying, well, I still know how to convert integers to strings. So here you go. We can solve this by putting declare strict types at the top of our document. And at this point, we will receive a nice type error. You may think, I don't want type errors, but it's better to figure out that you're dealing with the wrong data than to have it move through your system and screw up something 100 lines away. Drupal is also working on becoming more strongly typed. There's a few interesting issues that you can follow. One is actually getting it in coding standards so that people write their new codes using type hints. Another issue that I saw that's been open for quite a long time is to standardize on the usage of array type hints. We use arrays a lot within Drupal, but not a lot of functions actually declare that they need an array. There's also an ongoing discussion about implementing types in existing code, but this is a little difficult because if you extend a class, then it still needs to stick to the same agreement that the parent class made. And if you start changing types, then you can get mismatches there, and PHP will start complaining, so you could break existing sites if you change types on older codes. There's actually two coding standards discussions going on at the moment. I'm not entirely sure what the difference is anymore. Maybe you can mark one as a duplicate. We can look at strongly typed JavaScript, but JavaScript really doesn't care about types and just goes all over the place. But if you do want your types, there is TypeScript to look at. But that too is a completely separate talk that someone can give. Another cool feature in Rust is pattern matching. Patterns are a special syntax in Rust to take a certain value and figure out what shape it has, and depending on the shape of the value, to execute some functionality. A basic example is this. We have some variable that's an integer, and we can match this against specific numbers, or at the bottom we can say, well, for everything else, just print anything. This is very close to the switch statements that we know in PHP and JavaScript. So this actually does the same. But they can be a lot more powerful. For example, we can match against ranges. And while matching against the range, so we want to match anything from 1 to 5, we can still get the actual value that was matched there. And we can also, instead of using the anything operator, we can just say, OK, print in all other cases, also print it with this other message. But we can also use enums, and I'll explain in more detail what those are in the next few slides, where you can actually see that we can have an object with a value, and depending on what value is in the object, we can also run different branches of the code, which is something that we cannot do in PHP switch statements, unfortunately. So the enum you just saw is also not something that is supported in PHP, unfortunately, but it is something that we use. It's a way to group different values that something can have. And we can see it, for example, in the language interface, where we declare a direction left to right or a direction right to left. And this would be a great candidate for an enum, because we could say that getDirection always returns some value that is in that enum. And in this case, it just returns a string and it says, well, it's going to be this or that, but no promises on the language level. If we focus on that interface, then this also means that we can create an implementation for that interface that is valid from a language standpoint, but doesn't really make any sense in an actual application context. And you can see it here, this won't throw any type errors, even if we would specify that it has to return a string. But outside in languages, it's not something that you'll find really useful. Enums are a nice way to solve this because you can very strictly define what is going to be returned, and in Rust at compile time, it can make sure that you're actually sticking to that. So an example of all the possibilities for enums in Rust is the web event. This is actually from the documentation, and it shows you that it can have simple values that are basically just a flag to indicate something, like a right to left or left to right example. But we can also make simple structs that hold a value, like which key was actually pressed, or even more complex data structures, like where on the screen someone clicked with their mouse. Another concept of Rust that I would like to introduce, which for the average Drupal developer may be weird, is that null as a value does actually not exist. I think quite a few people may have seen this issue or this error message at some point during their programming, and it's actually caused by the fact that we have null in the language. One example of how you could trigger this is that you see this is the documentation for the entity load method, which says I can either give you a valid entity, but if I haven't found a valid entity, then I will give you null. And many beginning developers will simply happily write load a node and give me the label, but that means your code breaks if you don't handle the null case, because you're not forced to do this. We can try a similar thing in Rust by creating a small script that will open a file, create a buffer for a string to hold the contents, then read the contents of the file, and finally print it to the terminal. However, because Rust doesn't have null, it needs something else. So what we see when we try to compile this is this error. It says method named read to string found. It's not part of this result type that we got. So if we go back one slide, then you can see we're trying read to string, or we expect to have a file from our file open. We're actually getting something else. So instead of null, we go back to our enums, where we say we create a result enum, and this result can be declared for a type t, so this is the type of the result value, and also for an error type e, which is the type of error that you can give back. And this is defined in such a way that it can be used for errors for file input outputs, network errors, and all other things. And there's two possible values for such an enum. One is OK, which passes you the value that you want, and the other is the error, which gives you an error to handle. So this is the definition. So, OK, we've seen our match. We've seen that we can use a match statement to transform an enum into some other value. So we'll be smart, and we'll say we match the file, and when we have OK, then we get this actual file handle that we can use, and then we can read the contents of the string. And what you see here, expect, is basically saying if there's an error while reading the string, or while reading the file to a string, then just give up and abort the program. But if we try to run this, then we get another error, and that's because we don't have all the possible values of the enum handled. And this is one of the powers of Rust, in that it that you can define these enums in such a way that you have your good state and your bad state, and Rust will always force you to handle all the cases. So you have to think about your error handling, and the example at the start that we saw where you just load a node and then try to read the label without checking if it's actually there, it's really powerful. If you do this the first time, it's a little frustrating because you'll see this error quite a lot, as well as the error before. But if you do this for a few weeks, then you start to get, you'll have ingrained in you that you always need to handle both the good case, which is fun to handle, and you have to think about how you handle the bad case. And I think that is something that a lot of programmers in other languages can do better. We see it in the open social code base as well, where we're not defensive enough in trying to figure out when things could go wrong and dealing with it. So yeah, that's something I really like about the Rust language. On to another language, JavaScript. Has nothing to do with Java, named similarly, but it's still a lot of fun. JavaScript was my introduction to closures. And a closure is a small function that captures the value of a variable from outside of the function. There's great documentation if you want to read some more than what I'm telling on Mozilla's developer network for all concepts JavaScript. And we'll actually borrow some examples from them because great programmers steal. So you can see here that we're creating a function inside another function that says display name, and it's using a value from outside of this function. And this works just fine. And if you're thinking, you may think, okay, well, name still exists when I'm actually calling display name, so maybe that's the case. But we can go a step further and show you that that is actually not what happens. We create a function that can give us another function, and instead of calling the displayName function directly, we actually return the function and we execute it later. And you can see that the variable name that we defined at the top is actually already out of scope, but you can still see that it correctly outputs Mozilla, because while creating the function, it will actually create a snapshot of the variables around it and save the ones that are referenced inside of the function. And this is really powerful because it allows us to create factories for functions that are that have partial arguments. So we can create a function that does something very generic and then pre-populate it with a certain value. One classic example of this is the add function, where you basically say, I want to be able to create, I'm going a little bit too fast, sorry. I just wanted to show that error notation is the same. So we'll be using error notation in the next few slides because it's a little shorter. But the top function declaration and the constant are actually the same. So here's the make adder, the classic example. Where you can say, I want to call this function with 6, and now I have a function that can add 6 to whatever arguments I give it. And that's actually a good start of how you can create partial functions and start composing functions. And that brings us to functional programming.
Question about this.
Yeah, no, you can. Can also go like
so it calls along add 6 and it pass 9. But it's not about 9 and 6 and the other way around.
No, actually. Yeah.
But what if you want to pass like a variable? How do you pass it on? So if you say add 6 with.
You would just do it the same
T
way.
T or S or whatever, but it's already defined.
How
how does it get passed on? What's the reference to.
So what it captures here in the. In the make adder function is only the value of x. So that's at the make adder, and it has 6. You have 6 is copied into x, and it returns a function that says y is 6 plus y. And that's just a classic function. So you can give it a static argument like we did here, but you can also call it with a variable that has some value.
Need to reuse a
Functional programming, yes. So let's imagine that we have a shopping cart and we have all our prices in dollars, but we really want to know the price in euros. The simple thing would be to create a loop in the length, and then we just modify all the prices, and then we can see, okay, now we have all our prices in euros. One downside is that we no longer have our original cart, so we would have to make a copy first. And I also don't really like to write loops, but that's maybe a personal thing. Because another way that we could do it is to use the map function. And the JavaScript map function will iterate over an array, call the function for each element in the array, and create a new array with the return of the function for each element. So instead of creating a for loop, we say, okay, map over the cart, and for each item, we create a new value that has the same label with a different currency, and we can transform the price. And we can combine this with our partial function creation, where we say, we have a create card exchanger that takes a currency and an exchange rate, and with that it'll create the function that we just wrote by hand, and we can pass this function to our card map, and that way we can convert both to euros and in this case to yen. We can also do this in PHP, where you use anonymous functions, but in PHP you actually have to do something slightly different, and you have to actually use the variables that you want to take from outside of the function scope and take it with you into the closure, which you can see here as well. We have a create card exchanger, we return a function that will take one item, it'll capture the currency and the rate, and when that function is called, it will return a new item with a label, a new currency, and a change price, and we can create a card exchanger here, and we can pass this to the array map function. This is also one of the things that you see that is syntactically slightly different between JavaScript and PHP. In JavaScript, you can call the map function on the array itself, and in PHP, you actually have to call it as a separate function. This is mostly interesting when you start to chain these things, where in PHP you'll get a big blob, and in JavaScript you can just neatly put it one after the other. PHP 7.4 will introduce short functions, which are closer to the closures that are in JavaScript, and you no longer need to define which external variables you want to keep inside of your closure. And they also adopted the fn name to show that this is a different kind of function, and it's also slightly shorter to write. And that's my JavaScript, but I want to continue with the functional programming because there's actually quite an interesting transform that that has been popularized by someone using Perl, and it's called the Swatchin transform. It's made to use when you're sorting elements and you're sorting based on some property of your items that has to be calculated but is expensive to calculate. So an additional advantage if you use it correctly, which works better in JavaScript, where I'll show you how it works, than in PHP, is that it works without intermediate variables. And this is great for your memory consumption, because even though you have a short spike, the garbage collector can more easily tell that you're no longer using the variables. I've tried to do this in PHP first, but what I said about the array map is that you get this horrible nesting and you can't figure out what's happening. It's actually quite elegant if you do it in JavaScript. So to demonstrate, we'll start with an unsorted array. What I've done here is create a custom source function that increments a counter every time it sees a certain value, and you can see the output on the right. And as you can see, each element actually comes by in your sort function quite often. So that means that if we would have to do some calculation here, this quickly becomes quite expensive. This is only 6 elements, but the more you grow your array, the more this will grow as well. This would be the naive example. In this case, the slow transform function is a function that sleeps for a second to imitate some calls in the network or maybe some complex mathematical computation, and then it returns the value scaled by 2. Which doesn't matter for sorting, but it's useful for our example. I ran this locally and took about 22 seconds, which is roughly the amount of times you see each individual item. So there's a better way to do this. If we transform before we do our sorting, then we will only need to visit each item once. So this actually works quite well. It sorts in 6 seconds. The only problem here is that we're not interested in our output in the sorted transformed value, but we want our original values sorted by the transformed value. So this means we need to add an extra step. And the way to sort that is to, instead of mapping to our transform directly, we create an intermediary array for each item, which has both the original item and the transformed value that we can use to sort. And in our sorting function, we can sort by the transformed value. And afterwards, we simply map again, discarding our transformed value and leaving only our sorted original array. That was my examples, and I want to leave you with a little bit of Ruby style guide wisdom that was at the end there as well. It says, be consistent, doesn't really matter what you do as long as you do it consistently, and use some common sense. I can expect that this was quite fast, so if there's any questions, then don't be afraid to ask. If you want to read whatever came by, then the slides are online and all the code snippets are online as well. If you have some time, then you can also fill out a short form to give me some feedback for my next presentation. Thank you.
So a lot of deep stuff at the afternoon. I can imagine there are questions, but we have a bit of a timing issue, I think. And we're at 7 minutes left until the next session.
That's
5:15.
I'm actually mistaken. Went way too fast.
Sorry. Yeah, we can ask the questions. So if there's any, please raise the hand. Yeah? 1 sec.
Going back to the and or example, I remember quite a long heated discussion about using that in Drupal because of readability. Because you can also just do it in an if statement, and you kind of know that you're going to evaluate the next bit if the first bit evaluates true, and it's kind of frowned on. So I don't know if people think about that, whether it's readable or not.
Yes, I was actually going to talk about the actual operators AND and OR also, which are slightly different from this, but I ran out of preparation time to get them in, and then you can even have a bigger discussion about it. I'm going to dodge giving an answer on this a little bit. I think it's personal preference. I agree that an if statement is probably clearer in a lot of places, but this also has its places.
I think it. Yeah. I personally actually think it depends on what you get used to. But
yeah.
You get used to reading. And just on a completely light one, there is, I think, an SPF implementation of enum, so it might be on its way into the language.
Ooh, that would be cool. Yeah, I was looking around whether there is something in PHP that does the matching as well. And there are some people out there trying it, but it gets really horrible really quickly. Yeah.
Anybody else?
Flabbergasted.
constant or another constant. And I was wondering, wouldn't it be better to return an interface instead and the interface or the class extending the interface may only have a get function returning the name, but for extendability I think it always would be better to use classes instead. I don't know if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so what you're saying is instead of returning the enum, you say that you're going to return the interface, which leaves other people free to add their own values to the to return type. I would say no, because what you see, for example, in the results type of Rust is that it's very explicit about forcing you to handle each case. And this is very powerful because it means that all your logic branches are at least covered with or thought about with some outcome. If you create this, for example, this match statement for an interface, then you can go back to the situation where you've covered two possible values, but you then get a third and you don't know how to handle it. So the power of the enum in this case is actually that it's so harshly defined and that it's not extended.
Okay, but I believe everything should be extendable. So, and since the interface would define what you can expect, it would be extendable. And
I think then. So if you're in this case, if you're returning an interface, then you're giving back a contract of how something is going to behave. And that is fine, because you can always use that knowing that that contract is implemented. In the case of an enum, where you say, I want to explicitly handle all cases, it doesn't have to be the same interface that you're getting back. And that may be the biggest distinction. So you can get either this positive result, which can be your file handler that behaves like one thing, but you can also have your error case that behaves like something totally different. So they're not entirely replaceable. Because you need to, in the case that you can get different things back, you need to know which interface you're dealing with. So you need some logic to handle that. And then an enum is good because you're basically saying, I give you one of these two interfaces, but never any other. So make sure you handle both of these and then your code will work.
Are there cases or languages where you have enums that are extendable to add extra values, not like removing them but extending them with new ones?
Probably, I don't know. I don't dare say no because there's always a language that will prove you wrong. But I don't know.
That's it.
Okay, thanks, Alexander.
We still have a gift for you. So you're a bit geeky. Well, like all speakers say.
Oh,
so it's a geek cookbook for you, so you can make geeky recipes at home.
Okay.
Enjoy. Thanks for your talk. And up to the last one. No.